think it was a Sunday morning. Clouds in the skies, smiles on the faces of people walking by. There was no reason to be sad, no reason to complain. And if you saw the sunrise, you'd probably understand a little more. I can't wait to be introduced
to the only one that matters. Bop, bop.
Say that you love me. Say that you're mine. And say that you'll be there until the end. Say that you love me. Yeah, that's enough.
My throat hurts too much to try to sing that.
In the streets,
all oceans between us.
I saw lights in your hair. It's a lazy summer day. Yeah! I've got two plane tickets to Paris. I've got two plane tickets right out of town. All right, that is enough of that.
Oh, my throat hurts and I'm getting lightheaded.
That was A Black Man's Breakfast by Foxy Shazam.
I'm supposed to play hide and seek with these fucking douchebags.
Welcome back to DigiBros, everybody. Let's answer some questions from Pyro Red, who says, I tried to think of questions for the show, but they all ended up being gender-related, ironically enough, considering the topic of the episode. I don't know what episode it was, so...
Meow.
Number one, you once did a short series about cool games that would appeal to girls in hopes that it would get more women into and making videos about games. But what about games that both genders find appealing, like Pokemon? Do you think these can help bridge the gap and give both sides some common ground to stand on? Yes. In fact, Tamashii Hiroka has
is
made that point
the
a lot.
Authority on that one.
Yeah. Though, sadly, her videos about the history of how games treat girls sort of is gone. She made a lot of points about how, like, Pokemon was, like, the biggest gap bridger in that it was a game that was completely agender for the most part. I mean, you had to play as a boy up until the third generation, but, like, the appeal of the series is not really something that's more boyish or girlish, you know? A lot of Pokemon are cute, a lot of Pokemon are cool, there's no assumption made that guys are gonna like some more and girls are gonna like the others, they're all just cool and cute and awesome, and, yeah, I think it probably has the most cross-gender appeal of, like, any game, probably. Yeah. It's a huge gap bridger. Alright. Number two, I've heard a female fan of BL...
Dude, they call themselves the Killer Bees.
That's pretty rad.
It's the Wu-Tang Clan.
Alright, I've heard a female fan of BL describe the genre as being somewhat rapey, and from the little experience I have with it, watching Genshiken Nidaime, or in 3 or 4 episodes of Love Stage, this seems to be the case. The character archetypes Seme and Uke also seem to provide opportunities for scenes like these. Do you think this is true, and if so, what do you think of it? Why do you think it happens, and how do you feel about them being filled with the thing you hated so much in SAO, rapey guys?
I've always thought it was really interesting. Like, I'm very interested in the rapiness of BL
shows. And it's super true. It's really, really true.
And it's in, like, all of them. I can't remember which one I was watching with Hope where it was just, like, super rapey. And it's like, why? Why is it kind of accepted and stuff like that? Where it flies under the radar as being rapey.
The funny thing to me the rapiness of it is that... Here's the thing. I feel like in our culture, and this is true of, like, all aspects of our culture, girls tend to see all the things that guys like.
Yeah.
But guys tend to see very little of the things that girls like.
Yeah.
You know, that's sort of the reason, like, that games so predominantly have, like, male characters is that it's been said before that women are a lot more likely to be willing to play a guy than a guy is willing to play a girl.
Yeah.
Right? And, like, I think just in our culture in general, like, guy stuff is sort of widespread and girl stuff is kind of under wraps. And it's funny because, like, I think a lot of women have a problem with, like, the rapiness of stuff that some guys are into. Like, they have a problem when they see, like, stuff that's rapey towards women, but then will totally not have a problem when it's rapey towards guys. Yeah, this is interesting,
like, the double standard of it.
But guys don't comment on it because they don't watch VL.
They don't
look at it, you know? They don't know about it.
But I thought that immediately when I was watching this stupid show with Hope, which she doesn't take it seriously at all, but it's like...
That one...
It was Junjo Romantica.
Oh, okay.
And it's just, like, super rapey guy. Like, that's the whole thing. And it's just like, this is really creepy and, like, super rapey. And it's just like, that's kind of how all of it is.
Yeah, almost all of it is super rapey. I don't know if it's that's just the fantasy girls are into.
I don't know if it's like an empowerment thing or like a, you know, like... you could really, like, someone could do a total huge psychoanalysis of this. I would love to
see
that.
I'm sure Cider knows someone who's done it, because he knows people who have done hentai studies and stuff. Yeah, I'd like to see some deep thought on it myself, because I feel like there's a lot of different reasons I could think of that I think it could be the case, but I don't want to say them because they might not. Yeah, you know? Like, I have too many, like ideas that could be the reason, but like none of them are confirmable at all, and I've done no research. So, I'd love to know myself why there's so much rapiness in boys' love.
It's weird.
I don't know
if it's like, I don't know.
At this point, the term male gaze is pretty well known, but I feel as though there also exists a female gaze and can be seen in reverse harems and BL. Do you think it exists? And if so, why does one often get said with so much disgust when the other also exists and is completely conveniently ignored? Well, that's pretty much exactly what I just explained.
Look at modern superhero movies.
It's just that guy culture is everywhere and girl culture isn't, and that's why I'm always saying that I think that the best way to even it out is to have you make more girl stuff, because then you'd notice that it's the same, you know. And the thing is, when you do that, guys are going to cry about it because they're going to say it's a double standard. They're going to say, oh, if we can't have this, then how come you can have that? And the point is, we should all be able to have everything. You know. And they're going to be fighting the wrong battle because they're arguing with the wrong people. But, like, yeah, there's totally a female gaze. There's totally characters, you know, oriented towards women. And, like, it's been really fascinating for me in the last, like, five or six years. I've thought about doing a video on this, like, the sort of rise of the Fujoshi culture.
Yeah.
Because... the moment that it became apparent to me that girls were becoming the buying force was Do-Da-Da-Da. Because Do-Da-Da-Da was a show that was like in terms of story and the fact that it's a light novel series and like most of the content of it would seem like a guy thing. But just by virtue of the fact that it had pretty boys as the main characters and it had a great ship as like one of the leads, the show was way more popular with women than you would think. And like,
and shit like Tiger and Bunny.
Yeah, and they immediately marketed it towards that. Like, as soon as they realized that women were the ones who, like, you never see like dakimakura of any of the women from Do-Da-Da-Da, but all the guys, you know, like, just it's just like the certain shows like caught on that way. And then we started getting stuff like Free, where it was like, this is like a high budget manservice show.
Yeah,
you know. Because there's lots of, like, trashy reverse harems that come out every season, but Free was, Tiger and Bunny was a thing everyone saw, you know?
I think we had a panel with the guy who did Tiger and Bunny or something, or some kind of interview, and they were asking him just, like, did you think that Kotetsu was going to catch on with the female fan base? And they're like, they obviously made him, you know, to be appealing, but how the fuck were they going to know that this old, like, this middle-aged man was going to catch on with the female crowd? It just happens he had a great personality, and he has that Oyaji Moe going on, and he became this, like, great character. And then there's shots, like, in the last scene in that show where, like, his suit gets blown open, exposing all of his abs perfectly, and it's like, this is where they've learned their female audience and they're marketing towards it.
There's definitely a point, like, with Kyoto Animation, which Kyoto Animation is known for, like, having like a predominantly female like staff, where like they started like making the guys as pretty as the girls, you know.
Yes,
like, not to say that, like, because there's lots of girls who are into like Kyon and Koizumi from Haruhi, but like, as of like, if you watch Kyokai no Kanata, It's like all the women are jaw-droppingly beautiful, and the guys are all pretty boys. Like, everyone looks like a K-pop star or something, you know? Like, everyone's beautiful. You know, Free is full of, like, beautiful men. The main guy from Amagi Brilliant Park is pretty good-looking. Like, they pretty much made it to where, like, they evened it out and made it. And I think more and more shows are doing that. More and more shows want to have both the attractive guys and the attractive girls. And, like... and net the double audience, because they realized that it was a fucking... I mean, the thing is with anime, that literally what happened is what, like, all the... Okay, every, like, woman or feminist, like, campaign about games is always saying that the biggest issue here is that there's a huge market for games aimed at women, like, that is not being tapped, you know? Yeah. And there was even, like, a seminar where, like, someone was like... Women want to buy your games. Make your games in a way that women will want, and they will buy your games, you know? Yeah. And anime, I think what happened is the whole industry realized it all at once. I think around the time that, like, Doodadada and Tiger and Bunny, which came out at, like, the same time, I think around that period, then it suddenly became apparent that women had a huge buying power in anime fandom.
Yeah.
And if you, like, go to, for instance, Komike, like, one of the days is just nothing but BL day. You know, Komike is three days long, and there's a day that's exclusively BL. So, like, yeah, there's a huge, you know, amount of Fujoshi buying power. And, like... And anime studios just kind of figured that out and went for it. And I think as a result, there's more women getting into anime now than ever before, you know? And games need to realize the same thing. As soon as they do, they're going to have a huge explosion of female users. And then this whole thing where, like, it's constantly the, you know, women getting harassed and having problems in the gaming community, all that'll go away when there's enough women.
Yeah.
You know? Like... The only reason guys still get away with the guy club mentality is that there's still so many more guys who are into it, you know, whereas if there were a significant amount of women who cared about this shit, then, like, it would even the odds.
What the fuck are these last two kids, man?
Anyway, last question from this person. Number four, I feel as though Otoko no Ko characters, more commonly known over here as traps, have become a lot more prevalent in anime within the last few years. While before it used to be a one-off gag, I know it's become a full-on character archetype in the same way as Tsundere and even gets male gaze scenes like in Hime Goto. What do you think started this trend, and what do you think about the fact that it's clearly supposed to appeal to male audiences? I actually don't know that it's gotten, like, percentage-wise more common. Like, in terms of, like, there's a lot more shows coming out now, so there's more of these characters, but I don't think that they necessarily were in a fewer percentage of shows. Because I've seen, I'm like, hesitant to use the word trap, because I know that in a lot of communities that's seen as, like, an insulting term for a trans person, but, like, I don't know. I don't see how that phrases it. I guess I can understand why it would be insulting, but I don't really think of it as insulting.
Mm-hmm.
Anyways, I've seen these characters going way back, and, one of the first, there's a show called Stop Hibari-kun, which is just about a guy dressed as a girl, and, like, that's the main character of the show from, like, the early 80s.
Yeah.
Which is a pretty fun
Princess
show.
Princess Jellyfish, that's pretty good, but a cross-dresser.
Yeah, that's not that old. It's from, like, 4 years ago. So,
I don't know, it was just a show.
I was just saying that they go back a long ways. And there's, I don't know, does Princess Knight count as a reverse trap? I'm not sure.
I don't know what that is.
In any case, I think it's a popular trope just because it's, I don't know, I think we're in a culture where people like that kind of, like, gender play. You know, I think the kind of people who are into anime on, like, by and large, are people who are, like, a little distant from social norms and like things that sort of twist and play with the norms of our society. And I was big into that kind of stuff when I was, like, first getting into anime. I was really big into, like, Yuri. I liked the idea of, like, cross-dressing characters and stuff like that, just because it all plays with the nature of, like, what's considered normal, and I saw myself as abnormal, so I can relate to that, you know? I don't entirely know why guys are so into traps, but I will say that I think there's just as many guys who are into shotas and like just like if you've ever seen fucking Boku no Pico, then that's like a huge fucking OVA. You know, Boku no Pico is mostly infamous for the fact that Boku no Pico is mostly infamous for the fact that people would recommend it to people who don't know what it is, right? You go on 4chan and you say, what's an anime I should watch? And they say, Boku no Pico, you know, because it's like a hardcore porn about little boys who look like little girls. But Boku no Pico is like one of the most well-done porn anime ever. Like, the animation quality is insane. I've been told it actually has a pretty decent story. I've never actually, like, watched the whole thing. I've just, like, seen clips of it that, like, had crazy good animation. But, yeah, like, there's clearly a whole market for it and people who appreciate it. I think another thing I'll say about media in general is that I think most people who have a problem with, like, uneven representation just don't look at underground shit. You know, like, if you dug up the underground of anime, it would completely tip the scales from what they are currently. Like, if you thought that culture was most, like, if you thought most porn, for instance, was, like, male-oriented, dig up anime porn, dig up the underground of it, and you'll find that there is probably just as much yaoi as there is
anything else.
You know, you can't go onto a porn site and not be hit with a fuckload of yaoi.
Go to a fucking convention. Jesus.
Yeah, go to a convention.
It's all about the yaoi. The yaoi flags and the yaoi
shirts.
If you
go to the
fact that yaoi exists as its own merchandise form.
If you go to Hendane, the place where you can buy doujins at Otakon, there's always a lot of crowd there, but the yaoi section is always packed to the gills with girls looking at yaoi and guys looking at yaoi. It's always fucking slammed on the yaoi section. Like,
they are busy motherfuckers there.
Yeah, but it's again, it's underground. People don't look at it. So I think if you dug up the underground, which is what I think the internet exists for, is bringing the underground to the surface and normalizing everything. I think that's where we'll go. I think if we keep digging stuff up and showing it to the world, it will eventually normalize things. And I also, I believe that the best way, the absolute best way to get society to understand and accept new ideas and new things about people is through art, pop art. Because I think that the reason that gay people have become so much more accepted in the last 10 years than they were before is entirely because of Queer Eye for the Straight Guy, Glee.
Oh, yeah.
Like, these TV shows that, like, prominently featured gay characters in positive roles. Like, because that's the... For someone who doesn't know any gay people, and their only perception of them is, like, an idea they have brought on by, like, their social circles, when you show them a positive gay character, it changes their mind.
Thing going into that. Because Hope was telling me the other day that her mom had watched, like, I can't remember the name of the movie, but it's a movie about, like, AIDS and, like, gay people. It's not Rent. Because it was funny, because I actually said, like, she never saw Rent after, like, Hope described this movie to me. And she said her mom watched it and was, like, I guess for the first time empathizing with the gay person. It was, like, I guess, like, oh, they're all, like, she never thought about it before. And, like, now she's okay with it on a new level where she had not been before. Just from, like, just not ever thinking about, like, gay people on a deep level. And it's, like, that shows the influence of something like a movie where it's just, like, it introduces an idea to people who had never just thought about it to any extent. Like, someone like me, it's, like, I've thought about it, you know, endlessly, and I've grown up with a lot of gay friends, and I've questioned my own sexuality and things, and it's like, so that, for me, it's really familiar, it's really obvious, you know, how these things work, but, you know, some people who grew up in a different generation, they might not know anything about
it. Have you ever heard, this is one of the, like, I encourage you to find this article, I don't know what it's called, but, like, this is one of the most heartwarming, awesome, kick-ass things I've ever read on the internet. there's this guy, this black guy, who goes around talking to KKK members and collecting their masks after he convinces them to like black people.
Holy shit. That's fucking awesome.
And what happened was, he was like, basically the story began, he was in a bar in like a southern city or whatever, and like some guy like just literally came up to him and like was giving him shit.
Mm.
And he just started talking to this guy and like reasoning with him and made him completely change his perspective on black people.
Uh-huh.
And eventually they became friends and he gave him over his KKK mask.
Wow.
And so this guy began,
that's fucking insane.
This dude began a journey and he literally like seeks out KKK members, talks to them, and collect. He has a closet full of masks of former that's KKK members.
Oh god, I gotta because do this. Because as he oh, put
no. it, you don't have to oh, do this. No. This is just for a heart piece.
No, there's a Triforce piece here.
Not for that puzzle though. It's for something else. There should be like something you have to get under the house, or you have to get that fire out and go through the chimney, I believe.
So I have to complete this.
No, break one of the pots, and I think it'll pour water on it or something.
Okay.
No.
Let me get an ice arrow.
Look up. Do you see the shadow that's on you? Look up.
You're right.
Look up. Yeah, you have to grab that. If you grab that, it'll put out the fire.
Yeah,
and
look at
the
you
house.
Being
you
a Zelda
not,
master.
I remember this, because you don't have to do the fucking puzzle.
They tried to fuck us.
I could not solve that puzzle when I wanted to get the heart piece.
I did, because I got 100%.
I
kind of want to try it.
No, dude, I hate these fucking things so much. I will lose my shit if you try to do
this.
Looks
like it gives me a set number of moves.
Anyway, so yeah, like, because, as this guy put it, like, almost 100% of the time, the reason that people hold bigoted beliefs is that they don't know anything about the people.
Yes.
They are raised, like, in an environment where they are taught something that is completely not factual about those people, you know?
Yes.
And, like, for instance, my ex-girlfriend had told me once that her dad, when she was growing up, her dad had told her that when white people die, they go to heaven and become angels. And when black people die, they go to hell and become bats.
Holy shit.
That's the kind of thing that people learn from their parents, you know?
Whew.
And so, like, but it's so, like, she doesn't believe that now because she, you know, met black people and grew up with them and was like, they're fine, you know? So, like, that's all it takes is, like, you have to pull people out of what they know and, like, teach them the truth, and they'll come around, you know? And this guy did that and has a closet full of KKK masks. Super fucking cool story. Would recommend looking that up and reading it if you're interested in this and you want to have some faith in humanity restored in this fucking crazy situation of the world that we live in right now. I'm going to end this episode, and when we come back, you're not going to be playing this game. I cannot watch you play this.
Okay, hold on.
Let me check my fucking data capacity.
Looks like we're doing okay.
Next time on DigiBros.
That's why you're leaving just like that.
Yeah, I have to.